Today on the BRS160, we're gonna heat this tank with a focus on stability. Hey guys, my name is Ryan. Welcome to another week of the BRS160, where every week we do our best to help you guys, members of the reefing community, enjoy your tanks and find new ways to explore the hobby. We do that by following the setup and progression of this 160-gallon reef tank. This week, you're gonna talk about temperature control. We'll cover different types of heaters, explain proper placement, and demo a few different heaters, accuracy, and variation. We'll also cover temperature controllers, importance of calibration, chillers, fans, and finish with our installation for the BRS160. There's a fairly big range of temperatures a reef aquarium can survive in, commonly anywhere from 76 to 83 degrees. Biggest advantage to running higher temperatures is increased metabolic rates, which can increase coral growth and something that most of us find desirable. There are, however, several disadvantages to higher temps with lower dissolved oxygen. The increased metabolic rate in fish means more waste, increased oxygen consumption, pest organisms grow faster, and the closer you run to the edge of what's tolerable, the faster things can go wrong. During a power outage or equipment failure, it's much easier and faster to experience a temperature-related disaster at 76 or 83 degrees, and this is why most of us shoot for 78 to 80. As to an exact number, you can find tons of polls around that show a pretty even distribution between 78, 79, and 80 degrees. I think most of those that fall outside this range are either pretty advanced reefers with specific goals, or those that don't have the equipment to maintain a stable temp in the desired range. One quick word on temperature stability. Basically, any seasoned reefer who has one of those epic tanks full of really impressive corals and intense coloration would say the biggest difference between their tank and the rest is stability of parameters like calcium, alkalinity, salinity, nutrients, lighting, and of course, temperature. This really shouldn't come as a surprise because basically every living organism thrives in a stable environment where it doesn't have to constantly spend energy adjusting to the changes in the environment or lack of elements necessary for biological function. Well, it's absolutely possible to maintain a healthy reef tank with unstable parameters. It's the tanks that achieve stability that will most frequently see the most growth and best coloration. Pretty much all of us will need a heater to maintain a stable temperature in the tank. Even in warm states, you probably use an air conditioner to cool your home. And even if you don't, you probably have some particularly cool nights in the winter. In either case, your home will be cool enough, you'll likely need a heater. There are four basic types of heaters common to the aquarium industry. These glass heaters controlled with a bimetal thermostat, which is basically a couple of dissimilar metals that bend at different temperatures to control when it turns on and off. Heaters with built-in electronic thermostats and controllers which turn the heater on and off. These electronic versions come in two basic types, one with an external probe to measure the temperature, and those with the probe built into the body of the heater itself. Lastly, there are also heaters that have no built-in thermostat or controller and require an external controller to operate properly. The bimetal versions are the oldest design, and I think the biggest benefit is a complete lack of advanced technology inside. The reason reefers don't use them as often these days is because the contacts have the tendency to get stuck together over time, which causes the heater to get stuck on and will likely be pretty devastating to the tank if you don't have an external controller or catch it quickly. Even though some can be more expensive, the electronic models are much more popular because most people believe they fail less frequently and provide a more stable temperature. Because of all the reliability concerns related to aquarium heaters, reefers have started to demand heaters without controllers and use higher quality external controllers of their own. You can use a controller designed for aquariums, something more industrial like the Ranco, or more feature-rich full aquarium controller. At this point, I think a full aquarium controller has become the most popular option because there's a ton of reasons to own one, and they have become so inexpensive, it's really easy to justify. For just over $100, you can pick up something like a Reefkeeper Lite, which is a lot more reliable and feature-rich than any heater's internal thermostat. Some advanced controllers like the Neptune Apex have some pretty easy ways to set up email and text message notifications, as well as access to advanced graphing. Within all these different types of heaters, you'll also find them made out of different materials as well. Glass, various types of plastic, and titanium. The titanium heaters are super popular because they don't shatter like glass can, and they also come with or without controllers. Plastic options are also less prone to shattering. One advantage of the plastic options is they can come in a variety of shapes. The Neotherm from Cobalt Aquatics is a good example. This heater is ultra thin and fits almost anywhere in the tank, and why it's one of my favorite heaters. To decide which one's right for you, you're going to have to weigh reliability, stability, and accuracy with wattage availability and price. For reliability, your best bet is going to be to read customer reviews. Be prepared that basically all of them are going to have a healthy share of bad reviews, so this is really a game of picking the best of what's available. Make sure to actually read the reviews rather than just look at the stars, because there's a big difference between a lot of complaints about it being off a degree or two, which is super common, and a heater that failed them completely. To help provide some insight into accuracy and stability, we performed a couple of demonstrations to give you an idea how some typical heaters perform. We used 5 100-watt heaters, starting with the Eheim bimetal glass, a digital glass version with the Phoenix HPS, an analog glass with the Hydor, a flat digital heater with the Neotherm, and a titanium HMO heater from Phoenix. The goal here is just to give you a general idea of what to expect and not provide definitive proof which one is better than the other. This will hopefully provide some incentive to other reefers to do some similar tests on their own heater and share the results in the comments area down below. The most important element to me is stability and the size of the temperature swings each has. We let all the heaters run in a 5-gallon bucket with a small couple watt circulation pump and use a Neptune Apex to produce charts so you can see exactly how they perform. The biggest variance we found was with the Eheim Jaeger True Temp, which had a pretty consistent 3-degree variance as it cycled on and off. 3 degrees is probably larger than most reefers would want for their reef tanks. I will note that it's one of the very few UL-listed heaters out there, so it's likely one of the safer options and a solid candidate if you're going to use it on a controller, which most of us will. The glass Phoenix HPS had a somewhat consistent 1-degree variance, which is inside of the range that I would call acceptable, followed by the Hydor with a 2 to 3 tenths of a degree variance, which is fairly impressive for an inexpensive heater. The Hydor is also the only other UL-listed option we demoed as well. The Phoenix HMO Titanium is also very stable, with just a couple tenths of a degree variance. However, I think the most impressive was the Neotherm by Cobalt Aquatics. This thing is just flat, meaning the water didn't change temperature in any way detectable by the Neptune Apex. I found that to be almost too good to be true, so we moved buckets and tested on a different Apex temp module and got the same results. I think this is the only heater where I might consider using the heater's internal thermostat as the primary and my aquarium controller as the backup. The other element we tested was accuracy. All of the heaters were set to 86 degrees. I use a NIST validated thermometer certified to be accurate to 0.4 degrees, which is about as good as you're going to get without spending a fortune. Because it's NIST validated, I trust it more than I trust the aquarium equipment. The Hydor and Eheim came in over 3 degrees higher at 89.2 and 89.3. The Phoenix HPS was just 2 degrees higher at 88.3. The Phoenix HMO Titanium and Cobalt Neotherm performed the best at just 1.5 degrees higher at 87.6 and 87.5. Moral of the story is don't assume your heater is accurate out of the box, because it probably isn't as close as you might think. Also, don't assume your aquarium controller is accurate out of the box either. I found controllers to be off as much as 6 degrees. You absolutely need to calibrate your controller if it allows for it. Sadly, if you read the details on most thermometers you'd use to calibrate your controller or heater, you'll find them to state an accuracy range of plus or minus 2 degrees, which is a pretty big range. Thermometers with tighter accuracy or certified to provide valid results are typically prohibitively expensive, often 70 to 100 bucks. Your best bet for calibrating is finding 2 or 3 cheap thermometers and averaging the results. The OXO Pen Style, JBJ Digitemp, Lamotte Armored, and Lifeguard options are all around 20 bucks or less and suitable options. When you place the heater in your tank, you want to make sure to place it in an area that would be very difficult to run dry to prevent damage to the heater, sump, and potential fires. For instance, the same area as your return pump is a bad idea. If you ever forget to top off your tank, this area can easily run dry. Also, if you use an aquarium controller with its own temperature probe, make sure to place the probe in a different area than the heater itself, ideally in the tank itself or in a chamber before the heater. This will help you keep the temp more stable, but also help with your alarms and notification system when your return pump fails or runs dry. If the probe and the heater were in the same area, it would only heat that single chamber, but the controller would think the tank is fine. Placing it in a different area will let the controller know the tank is cooling down so you can do something about it. Some of you may find the need to cool your tank. Maybe because it's hot in your home, you have a lot of equipment or lighting on the tank, or you have very little evaporation, all of which can cause the tank to overheat. The best way to keep the tank cool is remove the offending equipment and replace it with something more efficient so you just don't have to be concerned with this. The next best way is to increase evaporation by making sure the surface of the water is breaking by aiming a power head and fan at the surface. This can be done both on the tank itself and the sump. For a fan on the tank, I think it's nice to spend a few extra bucks to get something low profile and quiet like the Tunes AquaWin. For the sump, an inexpensive clip-on fan like the Air King is the best option. If that still doesn't do it, you're going to have to consider a chiller. I honestly try to avoid chillers at all costs because they're expensive, take up a ton of room, and require a lot of power, which you might not have available near the tank. A chiller is more or less an air conditioner, so it also adds heat to the room, can't be cycled on and off constantly because it would be bad for the compressor. You'll inherently have larger temperature swings each time the chiller turns on and off, which I also find undesirable. If you do install a chiller, I find the JBJ chillers to be the most reliable, amongst the smallest form factor, and the quietest I've ever used. They also have a super helpful calculator on their site where you can enter everything that's on your tank and selects the right size chiller for you, which takes out all of the guesswork on something most people find pretty confusing. Once you have the right one, you can either use your return pump manifold or separate pump to cycle water through it and cool the water down for the tank. I'd avoid sending water from your overflow into the chiller because I don't want air, chunks of algae, or rogue livestock getting stuck inside the chiller. Okay, time to install our solution for the BRS160. If they came in the size I was looking for, I'd personally select the Neotherms from Cobalt Aquatics. My experience is the most reliable and stable of the heaters I've used myself. They're also ultra low profile and easy to place. I'm personally willing to pay the premium in this case. However, they don't come in the larger sizes I'm looking for currently. Hopefully they'll rectify that in the not too distant future. Based on stability, it was a close call between the UL listed Hydor and Phoenix HMO, but I decided to go with two 300 watt HMO Phoenix heaters. I may have to use three, but we'll see how these two work out. The Phoenix HMO seems to be the best mix of stability, price, and accuracy. The titanium body is also more robust than glass and in some ways safer. Coupled with that, the reviews are more positive than negative, so the choice wasn't really that hard. Because I'd never trust my tank to any heater's internal thermostat without some type of backup, I'm also going to use a Neostat temperature controller on each heater, which is the same controller that's inside the Cobalt Aquatics Neotherms. I'll need one for each heater. It is a bit pricey, which does make it hard to justify, but I think this is the best option for something like this. I'm going to set the Neostat controller to 80 degrees and the heater's internal controller to 82 as the backup. Depending on how accurate each are when I check them with my thermometer, I may have to adjust the temp of each to achieve the desired temperature for the tank and backup effect. The heaters are going to be installed in the filtration area of the sump, and due to the available cord lengths, we're going to install the temp probes in the return area. It's critical that the probes stay submerged at all times, so we found a convenient spot to zip tie the Neostat's temp probes in place. To be honest, on any other tank, I'd always install a full aquarium controller and use that to control my heaters. The Reef Keeper Lite can control heaters and a variety of other equipment for about half the cost of these two heater controllers, which makes a complete aquarium controller in some form a no-brainer in my eyes. In this series, we're going to show the individual standalone controllability options for everything, and then install a full controller near the end of the series, which is the reason I'm using these Neostat controllers now. A true aquarium controller will allow us to manage the temperature to a tenth of a degree, let us set the second heater up as a true backup just slightly below the first one. This reduces the power cycles on the backup heater and makes it more likely to work when we need it. The aquarium controller can also operate a fan or chiller as needed, as well as set off audible alarms. You can even plug in a light or something else to let you know if the tank is outside the intended range. You can also have it start powering down equipment like lights and unnecessary equipment to reduce heat. Last thing I'm going to do is put a reminder in my calendar to replace these heaters in a year. In my never-ending hunt of a high-quality heater, the only thing I found that really works is buy what's available and then just replace them yearly before they fail. In a world where we're spending hundreds to thousands on skimmers, lighting, rock, livestock, and other equipment, it blows my mind why there still isn't a reliable, accurate, and stable heater in a variety of common wattages we can really trust. Maybe the manufacturers out there don't think there's a market for them. I can tell you for sure, I'm one reefer that's willing to pay for something quality I can trust, especially on a piece of equipment that's so critical to the life support system of our tanks. If you agree, let us know in the comments area down below, and I'll use this leverage to get them to create one. That's all for this week. Next week, we're going to install the flow options for the tank, talk about all of what's out there in the powerhead world, and hopefully share some information you've never heard before. So make sure to hit that subscribe button. And if you like these videos, don't forget to give the team here a quick thumbs up. See you next week with week 9 of the BRS160 Flow.